What if I told you there was a PG-13 movie that's catered to families, followed a more or less typical Hollywood plotline, stars Reese Witherspoon and Tobey Maguire, and was actually kind of amazing? Well, this film exists and it's called Pleasantville.
Pizza time.
Pleasantville is a 1998 film directed by Gary Ross that so beautifully mixes the generic and formulated feel-good movies that studios pump out each year with a story that is thought-provoking and meaningful. Alright, so the film starts off with the most generic character tropes that you see in this genre of movies. We have David, the nerdy and socially awkward kid who desperately wants to have a girlfriend, and his sister, Jennifer, the popular girl at school who smokes and doesn't care for class. David takes comfort in watching Pleasantville, a 1950s-era sitcom based around a family of four. There's a $1,000 Pleasantville quiz contest going on in the town, and David wants to watch a TV marathon on the show to study. But Jennifer also asked some guy at school to come over to her house and watch the MTV concert with her during the same time. David and Jennifer battle over who gets to use the TV, and in their struggle, they accidentally throw the remote on the ground and break it. Luckily, the neighborhood pedophile, TV repairman, is instantly at the door when this happens without them calling for him. He gives him a new super remote with only one button, free of charge. I mean, at this point, with the whole magic remote thing, I was seriously concerned that I was just watching Click. So yet again, they fight over the remote and get transported into the Pleasantville show. Everything becomes black and white and the TV characters talk to them as if they were really in the show. The creepy repairman goes on to tell them that for some reason he is forcing them to live inside the TV show reality and they have to pretend to be their characters. David becomes Bud and Jennifer becomes Mary Sue, the children of George and Betty Parker. At this point is when the film transitions from a steaming hot pile of garbage to something actually great. David and Jennifer are forced to pretend that they are actually in the TV show. David has expertise on everything that happens in Pleasantville and wants to weigh everything out, while Jennifer carries a rebellious personality into the show and doesn't want to conform to pretending. This trait is one of the main driving forces of the story, which we'll see later on. In school, they learn that the people in this world have no concept of any other place other than Pleasantville. Everything is perfect here, while the players on the school basketball team can never miss a shot and everyone is perfectly happy. Also, we get to see Tobey Maguire live out his true self in becoming the next Steph Curry, and he absolutely slams behind the back foul shot. So the storyline of this episode that they are in is that Skip Martin, the captain of the basketball team, is asking Mary Sue out on a date. As planned, they both go to the local burger restaurant that Bud works at. Jennifer is fed up with acting along on the date and asks Skip to go out to a small pond in town called Lover's Lane, in which couples notoriously go to hold hands together. And no, that's not a sexual innuendo, that's literally all they do there. Well, after they get there, Jennifer starts to have sex with Skip, something that nobody in this reality does or even knows about. So much so that midway, Skip basically has to ask why his pee-pee's hard. But something interesting starts to happen after this. In the entirely black and white town of Pleasantville, Skip sees a rose with actual color. More color starts to show after Betty Parker asks Mary Sue what she did with Skip at Lover's Lane, which leads to her having explained the concept of sex to her. After exploring her own sexuality herself, the mother begins to see all the beautiful colors appear over the black and white canvas. Those who experience actual emotion or explore new things in their lives start to see or even get this color on themselves. The new color starts to spread like wildfire through the youth of the town, and the high school students become almost completely in color. These people are enjoying a new reality as they break through the one that once held them down. They're actually starting to live lives that resemble the freedom we have today, with the ability to feel love for each other and enjoy things like music and reading. There's a fantastic scene with Bud that drives home this new break from the norm. All the youth in the town are gathered in the restaurant, with most of them having some kind of color. Jennifer begins to tell some of the students about the books that they have in town from her incomplete memory. Except in Pleasantville, all the books have completely blank pages. As David goes in to start his shift at the restaurant, the other students ask him what happened in these books. When he tells them the story, the pages in the book start to fill in with words and the song Take Five by the Dave Brubeck Quartet starts playing. This is an incredible song choice to represent the change that is happening throughout Pleasantville. Take Five is a jazz classic that helped to bring back a renaissance of more rhythmically challenging music that was missing from the genre during its time. Like the title, the song has an odd time signature of 5-4, a shakeup from the 4-4 time that almost every Western song is in, including jazz at the time. Just like this song is breaking from the simple and sheltered music at the time, the town is drastically shifting to a new era of change from what was normal before. I think this is an amazing, subtle choice to set the scene of what is happening in Pleasantville. I'll leave a link to an NPR article in the description if you want to learn more about this piece. This change upsets some people in the town as their deep-rooted beliefs and views are challenged by a new way of life. This group against the change is mostly made up of the parents in the town. However, much like other social movements in life, especially the civil rights movement, the change is brought on and accepted by the youth of our society. Pleasantville brings up a great point on how having power and influence leads to the rejection of accepting social changes that challenges one's views. The children don't have any governed positions or titles that are keeping them from sticking to the status quo. On the other hand, the adults in the town reject the change that is happening. They want to stick to their values and their way of life, even if it pushes down people that are different from them. The leader of the opposition to everything happening in Pleasantville is the mayor, Big Bob. To Big Bob, the decision to take action is a question of values, the same values that have made Pleasantville what it has always been. He and the other men are upset over the changes that are happening, especially the fact that the women have more freedom now and don't perform the household tasks that they used to. Big Bob and the men represent the power and authority in Pleasantville. They feel most of the negative change due to this movement, but they cannot see how it is benefiting the lives of other people. They are blinded by the past and unable to welcome any new change. People in power spread around this influence to recruit others to their cause, like when Big Bob asked George to become a member of the Chamber of Commerce. People in opposition to social movements get roped in and awarded for sticking to what life was like before. This turns off people that possibly could have switched sides to help further the movement. Along with showing the two groups that are at odds with each other during a social movement, Pleasantville also does a great job representing major historical social movements. As the people who have color are treated differently and laws are made banning things from their way of life, like banning certain colors and songs, the comparison to the civil rights movement becomes pretty obvious. The people with color in Pleasantville are treated differently due to their physical appearance and that they have deviated from the norm that the town has created. Just like the issues in the civil rights movement, the oppression is systemic and institutionalized. The laws that I mentioned earlier that took away from the new class's life were voted on by only black and white people in the town. The people who were subjecting these laws had no say whatsoever. We also see very clear portrayals of segregation. Big Bob says that the town has always been pleasant and that he now needs to separate the pleasant from the unpleasant, the black and white people from the people of color, black people from white people. You can also see this take form from the citizens themselves. There's a very on-the-nose reference to segregation when the stores begin to put up no-colored signs. This expanded metaphor of the change that is brought upon from the color can also be related to the women's rights movements. The women of Pleasantville all follow the same archaic gender roles of society that were widespread during the 1950s. They cook, clean, and look after the children while the men go to work. But after they gain more freedom because of David and Jennifer, they begin to have more say in their lives. We see this most in Betty Parker. She gets color in her face and she becomes ashamed of herself. She doesn't want to leave the house in fear of showing people who she really is. In order to hide this, David puts makeup on her face, which turns her back into being black and white. I guess you could technically call this white face. But the act of putting this makeup on represents her conforming to society and having to appeal to a certain beauty standard, just like the woman in 1950s America. Betty also begins to abandon the role of having to cook for her husband each and every night. We get a scene where George comes home to no food and his wife is nowhere to be seen. She has found freedom from the confines of her marriage and gender roles, which allows her to actually live a life of her choosing. Betty begins to show love interest in Bill Johnson, the owner of the town restaurant. She's now able to choose who she wants to be with, where before her only possible option was to be with George. All this accumulates into a powerful scene when George tells Betty that she has to go to a town meeting on the issue of the people with color. He also tells her that she has to put on makeup when she goes there. To both of these, she simply responds, "I don't want to." George then tries to set rules for how she lives by saying this.
"You're coming to this meeting. You're going to put on some makeup. You're going to be home at 6 o'clock every night, and you're going to have dinner ready on this table."
"No, I'm not, sweetie."
This movie nails what women wanted in the 1950s. They don't want to just be seen as equals in the law, they want to be treated as equals. They want the ability to lead their own lives and do what they want, even if they're in a marriage. Most social movements have some kind of violent opposition. The black and white people of Pleasantville try to suppress the expression and freedom of the people of color. There's one night where they burn most of the books in the town that have begun to get words in Nazi Germany fashion. The movie also shows what are basically race riots. After Bill Johnson paints a mural on the outside of his restaurant, a giant mob throws rocks at the windows and trashes the inside of the store. The unique artistic freedom to the group of colored people challenges and scares those opposed. They feel as if the only way to get their past lives back are through violence and hate. The best part of Pleasantville is that it includes major civil rights movements, gender roles, government morality, and freedom of expression, all while being accessible to a large audience. You don't need to be some kind of mega genius or have a film degree to get a meaningful experience from watching it. It's a family-friendly movie that actually makes you think and reflect on how our society works today. Pleasantville is an anomaly in major Hollywood movies. There aren't really that many others in this genre that have such a strong social commentary and themes of suppression and dystopia. It's really a shame that Pleasantville didn't do too great in theaters, but with the wonders of the internet, you can still watch it. I highly recommend watching Pleasantville for anyone who wants a feel-good movie that still makes you think. And it's also a great example of Tobey Maguire not being a meme in a movie. Thanks for watching.